Thank you all for being here. My name is Peter Penning, work for ING. I see that the lion has found its way to the top of this nice billboard. Good to see that. While Kees is getting our gear ready for the presentation, let me start with the introduction. So we're going to tell you something about what blockchain means for developers. And I couldn't be happier than standing here in front of you today. Because GoTo, in its statements about what its purpose is, states that this is about lifelong learning and for developers, by developers. And especially the lifelong learning part resonated with me ever since I was a very curious, inquisitive little boy growing up in a house that had a few books. Learning has been a key part of who I am and how I have made my way through life. When I was 8 years old, I convinced my mother to become a member of the public library. And ever since, every week, I went to the library, got my books, got my learning, and I haven't stopped reading and learning ever since. So, very nice to be here. Part of my storyline actually is not just about learning, but also about unlearning, because we feel that this technology is actually so different and so new that part of making this work for you and part of becoming a meaningful member into this wonderful world is about unlearning. And that's what we're going to tell you.
I'm going to start regardless of the resolution.
Okay. You all have the app. Please do not hesitate to ask your question via the app, and certainly give us a rating, because that's very important for us and for the future of this event. We're going to tell you about how today's reality actually looks like from our perspective. Tell you a bit about Bitcoin, tell you a bit about Ethereum, literally the impact on you as a software engineer, and what ING is doing at the moment. Who of you actually owns Bitcoin? Fair amount. Ethereum? A bit less. Any other cryptocurrencies? Good, good, good. We have a good audience. Great. Okay, so if I can get the clicker, then...
Yes.
I will click myself through the presentation. I feel a bit like a deer in headlights in this room, so the room is very dark for me. I hope you can see me well, because I have a lot of light on me. But if that's the impression, then that's the background. So let's start about today's reality. How do we build applications? Basically, what we do is you are part of an organization, or you put yourself into the perspective of being part of an organization, and you model your world accordingly. The objects that you have, the domain level specifics that you have, are from within an organization. And then subsequently, you build software or you buy software, and then you integrate that and you put it into a data center, or you put it into the cloud. Kees and I have given this talk a few times before. The example we give here of modeling is from a educational organization, so higher level education universities, but you could take any domain. Could be a bank, could be a telco, could be anything. So what the way you model the world purely depends on the perspective you take. Clearly, this picture says very simply that depending on where you stand here, this is what you will use to describe your world. But more fundamentally, you get various versions of the truth. In this picture, the circle is just as true as the square. Now, if you try to reconcile them, then you run into problems. So what do you do? Technically speaking, you create a class diagram, you create some attributes, methods, relationships between objects, and you build it with a front-end application layer, database tier, and then you implement it further technically into what is here a database scheme. And every organization does it like this. So the example I gave you here very briefly of the world of a university, which has students, which has teachers, and courses. Each and every educational organization has varieties of that kind of model within the boundaries of its own organization. So, and here you see a large set of logos of universities, and you can see the difficulty with every organization modeling its own part of the world from its own perspective and having its own set of data. It replicates a lot, but you also get a lot of differences. And if you've ever tried to get your grades transferred or your diploma transferred from one education organization to the other, you know the incompatibilities and the difficulties in getting these the information exchanged. So that way of modeling is actually quite inefficient. It's inefficient because of the boundaries of a single organization within which you work. But that is today's reality. That's how we do it. So it's not very efficient. It creates huge amounts of redundancies. And how do you keep it safe, this data, within a single organization? Basically, you store your data in a database, as we just described, and then you get all kinds of measures to keep your data safe. So you define which version is production, you define who has access, you define logical access controls, you define network access controls, fraud detection mechanisms, all kinds of measures to protect your data. And in the end, with all these versions of the truth lying around, how do you know that your version is correct? You reconcile, because you think that maybe there is a version of the truth out there that should be in sync with you, and then you start reconciling. That's basically how it works today. So just to illustrate, you store it physically in a data center, you have access controls, very extensive security control frameworks, and then you hope that your data is well protected and safe. And well, let's have a look how that's working for us. The reality is that almost on a daily basis, we are confronted with all kinds of hacks, data breaches, software being malicious software being installed, and there is no end to the number of cyber threats that we are facing on a day-by-day basis. So the current way we do application development is not only very redundant, because each and every organization has its own data, it's also very, very difficult, I won't say impossible, but at least very, very difficult, to make it secure. And with all of us relying more and more on these solutions, it is increasingly becoming a problem. So, and that's where our story then starts about a new paradigm. And what I just explained to you about how we do it today, that's the unlearning part. That's really the part that you will have to leave behind. That is, going forward, so flawed because of its redundancy and because of the inherent insecurity, that's a paradigm that we will have to leave behind. Over to Bitcoin. Let's see how it started. It started with a white paper by a person who called himself Satoshi Nakamoto, and if you want to do yourself a favor and indulge in reading a document that is outstanding in its crystal clear thinking and writing, please read this white paper, because it is a marvel of clear thinking and clear writing. It's we can't give a person, a natural person, credit, because it we don't know who the real world person is behind the pseudonym, but we can only give it the highest praise. Launched in 2008, the white paper software in 2009, built upon dozens and dozens of failed experiments in the 90s and the early zeros, so before 2008. This did not come out of the blue. It was built on many, many lessons learned. And I have here part of the value of Bitcoin. And there you see that the first years, it literally did almost nothing. And then in 2013, it shot up, sharp decline, and then a steady growth again. So a fascinating history behind Bitcoin. And this is a screenshot of the market capitalization of the cryptocurrencies of February 14th, when Kees and I prepared this presentation for a lecture, a guest lecture at the Universiteit Utrecht. So when we revisited the market cap screenshot, we thought, wow, should we just replace it with a new screenshot, or should we make you part of the story that that we experienced that in the 3 months, 4 months that have gone since we started this kind of talk, something spectacular happened. Just focusing on the top three: Bitcoin, 16 billion; Ethereum, 1.1 billion; and Ripple, 232 million. And this is a screenshot of a week and a half ago. I deliberately did not take a screenshot this morning because we can amaze ourselves every day. This was June 4th, Bitcoin 41, so it was 16, now 41 billion. Ethereum 21 billion, up from 1.1, and Ripple at 11 billion, up from 232 million. And this is real money because you can trade all these currencies, cryptocurrencies, on exchanges. So we have witnessed something truly spectacular. If you talk to economists, the first word that comes up when you see these graphs is bubble, speculation. Could be true. It could also be that the future is happening as we speak, and that it's a bit unevenly distributed, as the saying goes. But in any case, it's truly spectacular, and I did not want to keep this part of the story from you. And maybe the most important thing that happened in the last 3 months is that the dominance of Bitcoin has fundamentally changed. It used to hover close to 90% of the total cryptocurrency value, and today it stands around 40%, so it's a spectacular drop. And there's all kinds of stories popping up now about when Ethereum will take over Bitcoin as the main cryptocurrency platform. So clearly this is not random speculation. There are things happening here, very interesting movements, and huge amounts of money being involved. Before we go to what it is, I told you part of my story is about the unlearning. Yeah? Learning to forget about how we currently model the world. The new world that Kees is going to explain to you has at its heart cryptography. Cryptography has been used to design from the ground up a fundamentally new way of modeling our world. And that leads to very surprising, unexpected, and new characteristics. You need to open yourself up about it and understanding that cryptography is at the heart of this new thing. And that also makes it, going back to the security flaws that we have in the current way of working, fundamentally much more sound and secure than everything we have seen before. I'd like to hand over to Kees to tell us more in detail about what this is.
Thank you, Peter. So we just saw that Bitcoin had many predecessors. None of them were successful, and Bitcoin was. And that all the altcoins that came after Bitcoin, they are also becoming more and more more popular. That's because there was something new about Bitcoin. It's decentralized. It uses blockchain technology, which allows to remove a trusted third party, but to put trust in a network, where you have these thousands of independent computers validating the transactions, And therefore, you can trust that what's part of the network, that is true. So it's a peer-to-peer network, and there's no central governing organization. The data is cryptographically protected. Instead of storing a plain text and then build a wall around it, it's at the core, it's protected. And the trust comes from the decentralized network. So what does a decentralized network look like? This is an example of a Bitcoin network where you see there's no main organization controlling it all. And there's everybody who wants to can join or leave this network at will. And there are several roles to play in this network. And you see all these dots. Every color has a different meaning. The black one is the mining. It means you take part in validating transactions. And as you do that, you try to solve a computationally hard puzzle. And if you win, you get a reward. In the case of Bitcoin, you get 12.5 Bitcoins. It's worth roughly 30,000 euro. And it's paid out every 10 minutes. The yellow ones, it's miners are grouped. Sometimes the miners join each the efforts in mining farms, and then they have some specialized protocol to share the mining rewards. The blue one, it's the blockchain. Everybody has who has the blue dot has a full copy of all the data. You see, for instance, that the ones below. Where there's only the blue one, the greenish one. It has the a wallet functionality, so simplified payment verification. The orange one, last but not least, that's the networking. Whenever you have a transaction, you need to broadcast it to your peers, who then broadcast it to the others, etc. So you can have different role. Full nodes have all the roles, and it's important to remember there's no central a trusted third party controlling the network, but everybody plays a role in it and can join or leave this network. So how does it work, this trust from the network? To understand that, let's look at the workflow of a transaction through, for example, the Bitcoin network. Let's say I order a pizza. I order it through Thuisbezorgd. They accept Bitcoins. That means I pay from my wallet. So I create a transaction, and I digitally sign it with my private key. The transaction is sent to all the nodes in the network. And all the nodes, they collect all the pending transactions, so transactions which are not yet part of a blockchain. And then they create a block with all the pending transactions, the hash of a previous block, or to be specific, the last block they trust, so they validate that all the transactions in it are valid. Then they hash that, and they use that as part of the new block, the previous hash, as it's called. Timestamp, the hash of all the underlying transactions, they call the we call the Merkle root, and the nonce. It's a number you can choose at will. Then if you hash that, then in order for the block to become valid, the hash needs to meet certain criteria. For instance, it needs to start with 10 zeros. Well, it's unlikely that the first time you hash it, it will. So you need to change the nonce. For instance, you increment it with one, and you hash again. And you do that over and over again until you find the winning nonce. That work, hashing over and over again, that's the mining. That mechanism is called proof of work. And if you're the first to find the winning nonce, you broadcast the block, and you get a mining reward in return. But only if your block only contains valid transactions. So everybody then validates your block. That's here. You broadcast your block, and if people trust it, if you have included only valid transactions, then all the blocks which are created afterwards, they will contain the hash of your block, the block you just created. So a block is a collection of transactions, and the only reason we have blocks in a blockchain is because there's overhead on reaching consensus, so we group transactions and then we get consensus on a collection of transactions, so on a block.
transaction message with the sender, receiver, and information. And mind you, a transaction is not necessarily a payment. In Bitcoin it is, but in newer generation platforms, like for instance Ethereum, you can run any kind of application that you want and send transactions to it. Consensus, the rules on accepting a transaction. So in the case of Bitcoin, is your Bitcoin only spent once? Does it have a valid digital signature? And does the block meet the difficulty requirements, the requirements for the hash puzzle? Some important concepts. Blockchain is distributed, immutable ledger. We just saw it is distributed, because everybody has a copy of all the transactions, all the data. It's a ledger because it's immutable, so the state can change, but only by appending offsetting transactions. It's like if you look at the Bitcoin, your balance only gets adjusted by in or outgoing payments. But where does the immutability come from? What we look at here is three blocks, blocks 10, 11, and 12. And block 11 has four transactions. And you see that the transactions, they're hashed, and every two transactions are hashed, and that's done over and over again until you end up with one transaction root, the Merkle root. The reason that that exists is for more efficient validation. If you want to validate one transaction, you only need to have the transactions that are in that branch of the root. So what if I would try to change the data that's in the blockchain? Let's say I ordered my pizzas with transaction zero. You know what? I can lower the amount and then make it close to zero, and then I ate the pizza for free. I own the private key, so I can so that part of the transaction will be valid. But if I want to do that, then hash zero changes. Hash 0 or 1 and the transaction root will change. That means that the hash of block 11 will no longer meet the difficulty requirements. It will no longer start with the number of zeros. So I will have to do the hash puzzle again, the mining again. And not only do I have to do that for block 11, but also for every other block that's added afterwards, because they contain a previous hash. And while I'm doing that, the rest of the network is adding blocks. So the only way I can keep up or overtake the main chain is if I own more than 50% of the hash rate of the network. That's also why in practice we say that as soon as... So the more blocks that are added after the block that contains your transaction, the more final your transaction become. And in practice we say if 6 blocks are added, then... we say it's practically final. It's practically immutable. So far we looked at Bitcoin, which we say is the first generation of blockchain. Ethereum is the second generation. It adds smart contract logic on top. Well, what does it mean? A smart contract, it's a piece of software that can automatically execute the terms of a legal contract. This term is not new. It's actually from 1994. And you can build any piece of software that can execute terms of a legal contract. But what makes it so powerful is the combination of blockchain, because blockchain provides the trust, the immutability, the transparency. And if you combine that with automatically executing terms of a contract, then it becomes really powerful. Just think of it. If you have an automatic payment upon delivery, for instance, for trade finance, goods are delivered to a ship, but upfront, the seller wants to know that when I deliver it, I want to know upfront that the buyer will pay me automatically. Then you program that in a smart contract. In order to run business logic on a blockchain, Ethereum built a virtual machine. Ethereum built a virtual machine because every node on the network runs the smart contract logic
in order to determine if your transactions are valid. And therefore, it's a fully deterministic virtual machine, and it's also properly sandboxed. It contains the concept of gas, because what does it mean for you as a developer if you program a smart contract? It means you can't do very computationally expensive tasks because they're run by everyone in the network. And you actually pay some of the built-in cryptocurrency for execution of your smart contract, so you should make it very efficient. And there's also a limit. So if your computational steps take too long, then you hit the gas limit. And the nice thing is there's a JSON RPC API. So in order to talk to the smart contracts running on Ethereum, you can basically use any modern language. As long as you can do HTTP calls, then you can send messages to Ethereum. So programming consists of two parts. There's the client part, where there's the signing, and you send gas to Ethereum. And there's the part that runs on the network. And you see every node runs the smart the smart contract logic you develop, it runs it on their own virtual machine. If your transactions are valid and the smart contract ends up in a valid state, then your transaction is added to a block. And then the miner gets to propose a block, including the transaction that you just that is processed in a smart contract. Well, when we say Bitcoin is first generation blockchain and Ethereum second generation, then there are also the third generation, so that the logos got lost, but there's Bitcoin and Ethereum, and the third one is Corda. It's basically not a blockchain in the sense that they, because they don't use blocks, but it is a distributed ledger, so you can share truth and trust that. There's Hyperledger Fabric, an open source project with open source governance and also many contributions from IBM. And there's Quorum. Quorum is a changed version of Ethereum. And basically what you see with the latter three is that where the first used proof of work, so the hash puzzle to reach consensus, the last three, so Corda, Hyperledger Fabric, and Quorum, they have pluggable consensus. So it's not strictly necessary to burn or to have all the computational waste in order to solve these puzzles in order to get consensus, but they have a voting-based, you can plug, you can configure which mechanism you want. For instance, voting-based consensus algorithms that still protect you against nodes that want to cheat. And also these last three blockchains, they are suitable for private networks. So there's not necessarily trust between participants, but you do know who is on it, and it's not open for anyone. And the first two, they're open for anyone to join Bitcoin and Ethereum. So what does all of this mean for us, for you as developers, including myself? I already talked or mentioned briefly the energy consumption. If you run something and it runs everywhere on the network, make sure you you program efficiently. If you have an infinite loop, Ethereum protects you from it, but not every platform protects you from that. You just do a denial of service through that on other nodes. Let's have a look at the smart contract to see what else it means for us. Because these smart contracts, because they run everywhere on the network, it also means it's open source by definition. Everybody needs to know what they're running, and it runs automatically. So I created a very small piece of logic. It has some functionality of a bank. You can deposit money, you can do payments, and you can retrieve your balance. And like I said, one of the things it means for you, it's open source. So you, if you make a bug, if you make a mistake and you introduce a bug, then it's out there for everybody to see. And it's also very hard to patch. If you have your own local application and you have your CI, CD, and it's a couple of times per day you can go to production and with a small fix, this is immutably stored. You compile this, you send the binaries to to Ethereum, you get an address, and it's stored there forever. So if you want to patch it, it's not impossible, but it's very difficult. So take these things into consideration. One concrete example, last year, there was a huge investment fund on Ethereum they made a mistake out there for everybody to see. Somebody saw the security vulnerability, he blogged about it, somebody else read the blog and exploited it. And he stole many Ether, the built-in cryptocurrency. It was worth $40 million. And mind you, to illustrate that, how tricky it is, I have recreated the same vulnerability in this smart contract. Although it looks easy to read, it might not be super easy to see the vulnerability. Can anybody shout the line number if you see where the vulnerability is? In the function execute payment, first I do a balance check. Do you have sufficient balance? Then I do a to call value, which means send Ether to this address. An Ethereum address can be a person, but it can also be a contract. That means from this contract that I'm calling here, and if I don't specify a function or a special function name, or I specify a wrong function name, in Ethereum you end up in the fallback, the default function, that means that from this function, I can enter here back because my balance was not yet adjusted. So I can re-enter and go out here again, etc., etc. So I have a re-entrance bug, which allows me to drain the balance from the whole contract, and only when I'm done, I keep a track of a counter here to avoid hitting the stack limit. When I'm done here, then the balance gets adjusted, and now it gets really interesting because I withdraw so much that I go below zero, but mind you, the user balance, it's a uint, so I get a huge balance in return. So the contract is permanently broken afterwards. So three things to remember, the gas usage, program efficiently, don't make mistakes, and because they're immutable, and it's also it's nice that it's JavaScript-like, this language, the Solidity, but you must thoroughly understand what happens underneath. This is the JavaScript that invokes it. Sorry, it's bad readable, but basically you have a JSON object with the signatures of the functions you're invoking, and you have an address of where the a contract resides, and you invoke it from there. So how can we guarantee this this quality? Well, one of the things that's popular in the blockchain community is formal verification. We're all used to using tests, basically sample tests, where you prove that for a certain input your program is correct, but you never prove that it's correct for all inputs. And formal verification does that. So you add formal specification in blue here, and then you have interpreters that statically analyze your code to see if there's if the formal verification applies for all known inputs. It does create huge overhead. There's the halting problem, so sometimes it's undetermined. If you would specify that your program would terminate, you cannot statically determine that for all pieces of code. And if you have external calls, like what I previously added, the re-entrance where you called another contract, then you also run into limitations of the method. So other languages, what they do is Ethereum is Turing complete, but there are also other languages like Bitcoin scripting, which are very limited, and then you don't have this re-entrance. So that's another way to prevent these bugs. We believe in Turing completeness, but with thorough verification. Ethereum supports this with Y3, it's a framework on top of Solidity. All right, but what does blockchain mean for ING? Who of you thinks that blockchain is a threat for banks like us? Okay, that's that's quite some. Let me start by explaining that. Thank you. With every new technology, things change. Existing business models change. There's new opportunities, but there's also existing business models that disappear. For instance, when MP3 was invented, there were the Napsters of this world that understood it, and they built nice application with it. And there were also the traditional record labels that just spend money on lawyers trying to combat that, to fight that. So it's the same for us. For blockchain, it's crucial for us that we need to understand it, understand the technology, build use cases with it, because the world is changing because of blockchain. And to illustrate how business models change with new technology, just imagine what YouTube would have looked like without the internet. And they would have like these huge boxes of videos, sending them around. Cat in a Box, Lady Gaga parodies, some music also. And mind you, this is how Netflix started, more or less. They were sending out VHS videos to customers, and because of internet, they started also changing their business model, adapting it, because they understood the technology and they adjusted themselves. And to see how blockchain changes business models, let's look at some startups. For instance, Uport, where you manage your identity and you manage who gets to see what part of your identity. Follow My Vote, voting on a blockchain. Guts, that combats music concert ticket fraud, where normally illegal traders just buy everything and sell it for a huge amount. Ujo, music platform, you pay directly to the artist whenever you listen to the music. And Everledger, that keeps track of the origin luxury goods, the origin and the ownership of luxury goods. So for us, we aim to thoroughly understand the technology, and that's why we do these things like the platform comparison that you saw earlier on. But we also research the fundamental technology, the underlying cryptography. For instance, how can you make a whole network validate data without disclosing the data? Zero-knowledge proofs, homomorphic encryption, those kind of things. We look at different consensus algorithms. Every consensus algorithm has its own pros and cons. Proof of work has huge energy waste, but it is very secure. And obviously, we develop applications to see where it's the best fit. And one application that is publicly known is the trade finance application, where there's an automatic payment once goods are delivered, where we now have bank guarantees, which are pieces of paper, which are physically sent over the world because previous attempts to automate this paper trail, they all failed because you cannot build a centralized system that everybody in the whole world trusts. And in these trade finance use cases, it's always about trades across the globe. So you need a decentralized system that everybody can trust, and then you can automate that that process. That's one of the things we're doing. But I think it's not hard to imagine, if you look at the unique characteristics of blockchain, so providing trust, immutability, decentralization, and if you look at the products and services that we as a bank deliver, most of them have a component of trust in it, so they fit very well on blockchain. All right, that sums it up.